introduction, and I am greatly honoured to have been asked to contribute to this now celebrated series of Max Weber lectures. So I want to begin by thanking you all very warmly for inviting me back here. When I received the invitation, it did seem to me that I have to try to say something about the state, and it would be good if you could hear me. Could you already hear me? Why? Because certainly in the Anglophone world, the work for which Max Weber is probably best known is his observations about the character of the state. I'll come back to that thought in a moment, but first I just want to use it to flag the fact that it is on the Anglophone tradition of thinking about the state that I'm going to focus this evening. Now, that restriction is not as arbitrary as it looks, because whether such terms as the Staat or l'État, der Staat, and so on, express the same concept as the state, is of course a question. It can't be assumed that it would have to be shown. I don't have time, obviously, to show that. So it's wisest to begin by imposing an obvious linguistic boundary. But if you were to ask me why an Anglophone linguistic boundary, let me hasten to answer that's not because I necessarily think that the Anglophone tradition of thinking about the state is the most interesting or the most important one. But it is the one that I claim to know about. And after many years of giving lectures, I decided to restrict myself, after some bad experiences, to what I know about. Well, this is a lecture about the concept of the state and some of those who theorize it, but you might well ask nowadays, is there really much to talk about here? Because we're frequently told that in our newly globalized in a newly globalized world, states are in steep decline, both in status and in power. And some commentators have even been talking about the death of state. They're obviously in decline in status, because as neoliberals have been telling us for decades, the means of shaping society by means of the state are bad means. States are monopolistic enemies of competition and enterprise. Markets, by contrast, are said to be good, the enabling friends of innovation and initiative. And states are likewise said to be declining in power, largely for the admittedly obvious reason that the continuing rise of international agencies and jurisdictions throughout the 20th century has robbed them of many traditional markets of sovereignty, and indeed sovereignty has by now become disjoint from talking about states. Well, these and other legal and economic transformations have convinced a number of commentators that states are now in terminal decline, and Frank Angerschmidt, in a recent article, has gone so far as to conclude, I quote, that now, for the first time in more than half a millennium, the state is on the way out. Well, until very recently, that line of argument was widely fashionable. But in very recent times, I think you'll agree, it's become less so. And that, I think, is because it's begun to seem to many commentators that that line of thought is somewhat weirdly out of line with our common experience. I mean, do we really believe that states and markets offer rival ways of doing the same thing? I mean, I'm about to say something which I fear, but of course I also hope, is kind of blazingly obvious, which is that states do and must do many things that markets can't even aspire to do. States print money, more of money. Some markets print money. I'm talking about what's legal. States print money, states impose taxes, they enforce contracts, they engage in wars, they penalize citizens, and they legislate with an incredible degree of complexity. There's no other institution in the world that legally does all those things except individual states. Certainly not markets, which have of late been sources of gross instability and have also been ever more revealing their dependence upon states. Not even the European Union, which is surely the most plausible candidate for being a host state or super state, does all the things that I've Meanwhile, it's not contentious to point out that the world's leading states remain the principal actors on the international stage and the most significant forces within their own territories. They're more aggressive than they used to be. They patrol their borders with extraordinary vigilance, and they maintain an unparalleled level of surveillance without their consent of their own citizens. And they've also become more interventionist, and most fascinatingly, in view of so much liberal, neoliberal talk about markets, in the face of their collapsing banking systems in 2008, it was only individual states that stepped forward as lenders of last resort. So to speak in these circumstances as even so great an expert as Frank Bankerschmidt has done, as the state, I'm quoting again, has faded into the shadows and is now on the way out, I think many commentators have been noticing in the last very recent years that that's kind of inattentive. I mean, that's one side to the point of inattentive. Or rather, I think this is what I believe, that this attempt to will states out of existence is actually part of the ideological project of neoliberalism. But you might have a different objection to thinking that states matter. It might be a moral objection, and that I take more seriously. As liberal cosmopolitans, I mean, you have never shall have ended up here at the moment, these writers like to point out that the focus that we have traditionally had in political theory on the state is to concentrate and in that way to validate a site of exclusion as well as inclusion, and hence agents of injustice. Now that objection I immediately grant that objection, but I want to add that in politics we're always confronting immediate questions and problems. And it seems to me that in political theory there's a strong case to be said for taking those immediate problems as a starting point. And the fact is that the starting point still is the state. We all live in states. Being stateless is an appalling condition in which to find yourself. So I'm going to stop apologizing, if I may. Is that enough apology? And I'm now going to talk about the concept of the state. Let me begin by asking, when we talk about states nowadays, how do we generally conceive of the state? Remarkably, I think that in the Anglophone literature at least, there's a remarkably well agreed answer. If you look at any current Anglophone handbook of political concepts, there's always a large article on the state. I've even written one of them myself now. And there you will almost always find the term explicated, usually with direct reference to Max Weber. Simply, I quote, for example, from Morris's book on the state, as the name of an apparatus of government, an essentially legal and bureaucratic apparatus, the distinctive feature of which is its claim to exclusive right to coercive control over some determined territory. You can hear Max Weber echoing in that account. And actually, I think we can go further than that and say that in current parlance in the English language, when we talk about the state, state has come to be a synonym for government. I think that's not too much to say that. I mean, to take an example almost at random, consider the excellent book of Mariana Mazzucato called The Entrepreneurial State. I was very struck reading it, and also even more struck by reading reviews. That, I mean, this is very common in the reviews. They begin by talking about how she's speaking about the state as an enabling agent, and they immediately move, as she does, to talking about governments as enabling agents. And in the book, and this is commonplace, state and government are used synonymously, just as you might use freedom and liberty synonymously. Now, that usage, I think, cannot fail to strike someone like me, an intellectual historian, as missing something that might be, or might not, but it might be of very great significance. And that is because when the vocabulary of state, statehood, and so on first emerged in modern political discourse, the whole point was to make a categorical distinction between governments and states. That was the whole point. So what has happened? I mean, we've lost the conceptual distinction that used to be thought fundamental to theorising government. Well, I want to try to do two things this evening. I want to offer a genealogy of the state, how that vocabulary emerged in the course of the early modern period to become the master noun of political discourse, and how that concept came to be understood. It has to be a genealogy, because there's no conceptual analysis to be given. There are only branching accounts of how to think about this concept, which are in contestation with each other. I shall isolate four quite separate ones. But then at the end, I do want to shift from history to political theory. I mean, I don't distinguish those two activities, really. But the shift is that I want to reflect on the genealogy. Genealogy is always critique, obviously, and I shall use it as such this evening. I want to ask, have we lost anything of value through the fact that what used to be a very important categorical distinction has been lost into synonymity? That's an extraordinary thing to have happened. Okay, first, my genealogy. This will sound a little dogmatic, but it's based on enough reading that if you wanted in the discussion, we could go into it more. But as far as I can see, the vocabulary of state, statehood, and so on first emerges in Anglophone political discourse with some suddenness in the opening decades of the 17th century. But at this stage, the terminology is not used to refer to any form of bureaucratic or governmental power at all. It is used to speak about the condition of the governed. So there are really two large conceptual shifts to be made. The classic account of this first phase is owed to Ernst Horowitz in the book The King's Two Bodies, which I'm sure is known to you more recently reissued. And Kantorowicz begins, you'll recall, by quoting a verdict delivered by the English judges to the end of the 16th century. The case concerned the disposition of some royal lands, and the judge vindicated the rights of the crown by referring to the doctrine, I quote, that the king hath in him two bodies. One is his body natural, no different from the natural bodies of others, but the other is his body politic, that cannot be seen or handled, and is constituted for the direction of the people and the management of the public will. Now, from as early as the 13th century, according to Kantorowicz, these political bodies, the corpus political, were in turn held to constitute kings or queens in some countries as head of the corpus. And so you have a third body politic, the body of the people. And that body is described in a variety of ways. Kantorowicz takes almost all his quotations from English sources, and almost all of those from Sir John Montesquieu's leading constitutional theorist of the 15th century, and he always speaks of the body of the realm. But if you move forward one century, as Kantorowicz does, and rely on Edmund Fowler's commentaries on the laws of England, you will find that the corpus politicum is referred to as the body of the people. Well, Kantorowicz carried his examination of the English sources no further forward than that period. But it's perhaps surprising that he stopped there, especially granting his wider ambition in the book, which he announces at the beginning, of contributing to an understanding of the origins and the mythology, as he says, of the modern secular state. Because had he pushed his investigations of the English sources just a couple of generations or less further forward, he would have come upon an epoch-making moment in Anglophone political discourse. And that is the moment in which, for the first time, the body over which monarchs are said to rule is not described as the realm, it's not described as the kingdom, it's described as the state. As far as I can see, you encounter that usage, first of all, in two related strands of early 17th century thinking. First, amongst theorists of sovereignty, and here the most influential text is that, of course, of Bardin, République, translated into English as early as 1606. At the beginning of Book One, Bardin begins with a definition of what his translator and his novelist calls the city or state. Let me translate it, civitas. The city or state. I quote Bardin in the translation. It is neither the walls, neither the persons that maketh the city or state, but the union of the people under the same sovereignty of government. So to speak of the state on this account is to refer to a community living in subjection to a sovereign head. So this head-body metaphor is made absolutely central to discourse about the state. The other and less interesting, more influential strand of thinking in which this became central was as part of the divine right, the doctrine, the divine right of kings. For example, King James I of Great Britain, as he thought an expert on exactly this doctrine, speaks to the Parliament of 1604 in these terms. You, the people, are the body of the whole state, and this Parliament is the representative body of the state. We kings are rulers of the state, and it follows that if your king want, the state wants, and therefore the strengthening of the king is the preservation and standing of the state. Now, of course, that usage becomes deeply entrenched in the English language. We've actually never given it up. We still refer to heads of state. But this head-body analogy, which is venerable, is in the next generation of thinking, and the genealogy moves down a generation at this moment, is vehemently challenged. And this brings us to the revolutionary period of British history. These critics who became the revolutionaries agree that when we speak of the state, we are referring to the whole body of the people of some distinguishable ethnos. But what they repudiate is the venerable image according to which the body, as Sir John Fortescue had said, the body of the people is asephalous, that's to say it lacks a head and therefore it cannot act. If it's to act as a body, it must have a head. And that is made to seem a kind of natural way of thinking about politics. But the response of anti-absolutist writers, what I should call a populist way of thinking about the state in this period, is to say the people can be considered in two ways, and here they draw on deep reservoirs of legal thinking. This comes from Roman law. You can consider the populace as a multitude, that's to say, singularis, as individual members of a multitude, or you can consider, and here they're thinking especially 13th century developments in the law, which I can come back to if you want to. You can think of the people, ut universis. You can think that the people is a universitas, that's to say, corporation. The people is a union capable of acting with one will and voice, and is thus legally a persona. And the name of that persona is the state. The first Anglophone political theorist to lay out that precise line of argument is called Henry Parker, and he deserves, I think, to be much better known. He is the most important publicist during the English Civil Wars of the 1640s to challenge the traditional mixed constitution of head, king, and body, parliament, king, and people, the whole head-body metaphor, by saying, unequivocally, the people own everything. So who is sovereign? The people are sovereign. Pick up, of course, by John Locke. You say, who shall be judge? I say, the people shall be judge. But it's Parker who introduces into Anglophone political theory, largely from French legal sources, which are in turn dependent on Roman law sources, the idea that the sovereign is the people and the king is the servant of the people, which again we've kept in the English language to talk about public servants. Signaling the thought that they are the servants of the sovereign, and the sovereign is the people universitas and society of men, a polity corporation with its own inherent quiescence. And the name of this union of the multitude is the whole body of the state. So the part of the question is, well, how is then power disposed between crown and state? The negative answer is, give up that metaphor, head and body. Kings are servants of the whole universality. Another quotation from Parker. Now, he goes on to say, well, of course, states can't act on their own behalf. The body politic is huge. It's millions of people. At that time, it was, 5 million people. Now, it'll be much larger. So someone's going to have to act in his name. And in England, those powers of action are allocated to the king in Parliament. But it's crucial that Parker is a theorist of what we now call virtual representation. I don't think we've got clear what we think about political representation, but some of us believe still in virtual representation. That is, the view that the representation is not just an authorised person, it is a person who in some respects, some crucial respects, resembles those who authorise. And the ingenuity of this particular theory is Parliament is, because it comes from all the counties, just as in the United States, part of the Constitution is the Senate is taken from each of the states, isn't it? Two persons, regardless of population. Why? Because it's a body politic and you're trying to represent the body in miniature. So it has to be a representation, i.e. a re-presentation of how the whole body looks in miniature. So, as Parker says, there's no difference. It's a very good portrait, picture, representation he's calling on. It's a very good picture of the people. So it is the people. The sudden mystical moment, it just is the people. And so it is the state. Now, with the abolition of the monarchy in Great Britain in 1649, the institution of the monarchy was abolished in 1649 in perpetuity. So how have we still got it? It didn't last long. But anyway, we're working on that. Let's forget that. Abolished in 1649, this theory of the becomes the official theory. And of course, it's immortalized because the main speaker on behalf of the Parliament weren't very lucky. They got the best writer of prose of the age, the poet John Milton, in The Tenure of Kings and Magistrates, laying out the argument that I've just laid out now on behalf of the Republican government. But that triumph was, of course, short-lived, and no sooner is that view of the state established, the state just is the name for the body of the people, than it is vehemently contested by monarchists of all stamps. Now, some of these writers, the most famous being Sir Robert Filmer in his tracts of the early 1650s, simply revert to talking about the divine right of kings. But at this moment, a different challenge to what I'm calling the populist understanding of the concept of the state emerges. And this produces a yet further analysis of how to think about the concept. Several writers contribute to it, but because time is short, I'll concentrate on just one. He's by far the most important. He's in the title of my lecture, Thomas Hobbes in the Bath. As I'm sure you know, he begins his treatise by saying, I speak not of the men, but in the abstract about the nature of the commonwealth or state. So it's a treatise about the state. Very important to remember that's how he describes the Bible in the opening sentence. It's a treatise about the state. Now, he turns to the question of the state after he gives you his philosophical psychology in chapter 13 of Leviathan, which is the celebrated analysis of what he calls the natural condition of mankind. He promptly launches a scathing attack on the idea that sovereign power could ever have been a property of the whole body of the people. And indeed, I don't think this is sufficiently pointed out, his underlying purpose in depicting our life in the state of nature as nasty brutish and short, bellum omnium, contra omnes, is to insist that the Parker image of the people as a united body It is just superstition. It makes no sense. By the way, the quickest way to understand what it's about is to see it as a commentary on Parker. You won't go far wrong if you think this is a book about Parker, who's frequently quoted in it, although never, of course, mentioned by name. The condition in which we are placed in this world, Hobbes wants to reply, is one in which we live not as a society, but, as he says, entirely dissociated from one another, in a condition of solitude in which every man is enemy to every man. And then he turns directly to Parker and all his followers, addressing them in his tone of utmost sarcasm. I quote, "Therefore there is little ground for the opinion of them that say of sovereign kings, though they be greater than each of their subjects, ut singulis, yet they be less than the body of the people, ut universalis." Because there is no such thing as the body of the people, the speech is absurd. All that is individual. The idea of a body of people is just a metaphor. We don't want metaphors in political theory. But Hobbes is no happy with absolutists, especially not divine rights theorists, and their view that what we want is a head-body metaphor, that traditional metaphoricality. He also absolutely refuses that. He fully endorses the radical contention that there can be no legitimate power which is not an object of your individual consent. If you haven't individually consented, it is not power. It's not authority. It is just power. So he never talks about rulers as gods, vicegerents, and all that vocabulary of the head-body metaphor that was traditional. If you ask Hobbes, well, what is the status of a sovereign? He says, a legitimate sovereign is nothing other than an authorized representative. So, having rejected both prevailing ways of thinking about the state, not the head-body metaphor, head of body of state, not the populist view, the people as a body is the state, Hobbes proceeds to lay out a rival conceptual analysis. Now he begins, and this is another epoch-making moment in Anglophone political thinking, by challenging their whole view of virtual representation. He says that's another superstition, this nonsense about representation meaning picturing. What is it to be represented by somebody else? It is just to authorize them. Authorization is a sufficient condition of representation. So if you ask Hobbes about the status of a representative, it is someone authorized to speak in somebody or to act in somebody else's name in such a way that the words or actions spoken by the representative are attributed to whoever is represented. So what does all the conceptual work is authorization and attribution. That is all that political representation can possibly be. Well, he said, and sovereigns are just representatives. Sovereigns are just persons authorized. But if they're representatives, the crucial question for this political theory then is, well, who do they represent? They can't represent the body of people, can they? Because there's no such thing. Well, to understand Hobbes' answer, you have to begin by attending to his distinctive account of the political covenant. A political covenant cannot be, as everyone has hitherto suggested it must be, a covenant between the universalist of the people considered as a legal persona and a ruler. It can't be that because there's no such thing as the people as a persona in nature. That's just not in nature. So if there's to be a political covenant, it can only be a covenant of a representative with each and every one of us. We are nothing but a multitude. So a covenant will have to be you, that the sovereign is you. That is the only model of a political covenant. Because everything else is just superstition. The idea that you're a body, you're not, look at you, you're all even dressed in. Well, actually not there, but the warm day. Okay, with that analysis, Hobbes arrives at his central contention about the political covenant. just agrees with everyone else. It's as if, of course, he even says that, it's as if each one of us agrees with everyone else, that some one person be our sovereign representative, that transforms us. It's a mystical moment. Because we're now united by our common agreement to live in subjection to law, and to the fact that we now have a determining will, that of our sovereign representatives, whose words and actions count as those of us all. So instead of being dissociated, we are now capable of willing and acting as one person with a single voice, because that is the voice of our sovereign representative. So as Hobbes puts it, I quote, "A multitude is made one person when they are by one person represented." So now you can ask, well, what is the name of the person brought into existence by the decision of the multitude to institute a sovereign representative? And the epoch answer is, the name of that person is the state. So for Parker, the state is the name of the sovereign body of the people. For Hobbes, the state is the name of the multitude united as one person by way of agreeing to live under a sovereign representative who represents that person, i.e. the person of the state. So the holder of sovereign power is distinct from both the sovereign, who's just a representative, and the body of the people. And so this is a distinct person. Hobbes gives it a name. It's called Leviathan. Leviathan is the proper name of the state. And he distinguishes the state not merely from the sovereign, but from any version of the multitude. Sovereigns are born and die. The multitude changes as its members are born and die. But the person of the state is, as Hobbes says, by intention, immortal. Now, this immortal person is fragile. It's, as Hobbes says, but a word, in a sense. It can't act in its own name, and it can't authorize anyone else to act in its own name. It's capable of speech and action only because the individual members of the body of the multitude have authorized someone to represent it. So the state, Hobbes says, is a person by fiction. That's how you should think. It's a fictional person, a persona fiction. That, by which she means, it's never truly the state that acts, it's always the sovereign. But it would be a great mistake to suppose that the fictional character of the state means that it's not of importance in the world. Because remember, if you're a representative, then your actions are attributed to the person whom you represent. The sovereign represents the state. So when the sovereign represents the state, not sovereign acting, it's the state that acts. So it's the state that declares war, it's the state that puts you in prison. Acting through the sovereign, but the power is that of the state. Now, as with the other views I've been considering, Hobbes' fictional theory, as I'll call it, the state is a person by fiction, is used to furnish a means of judging the legitimacy of actions that governments undertake. According to the absolutist view, of course, those actions are legitimate if they're performed by a recognized head of state. According to the populist view, they're legitimate if they're performed by the representing will of the universitas of the people. According to Hobbes' theory, they are legitimate if and only if two conditions are satisfied. One is that the sovereign, man, woman, or assembly, or all of us, do it that way, have authorised someone, could authorise all of us. It could get quite complicated. Democracy is not a union. The decision to authorise might be to authorise us as a person. But then you've got two persons, he says, so don't do that. And the second is that the duty of that representative person is to procure the good of the fictional person, the welfare of the state. That is the duty of the sovereign. otherwise it's not legitimate territory. Okay, there is Hobbes' theory, and that has very little influence on Anglophone literature. It's quite difficult actually to understand the theory, but it has an enormous impact almost immediately on continental natural law theories of the state. And the great conduit here is Samuel Bufendorf in the De Jure, 1672. Translation into English, and it comes back into Anglophone discourse in 1717. Now it's true that Bufendorf is a great Hobbes, but he's critical of something in Hobbes, which is the idea of a persona facta. Because as Bufendorf rightly sees, according to Hobbes, anyone or anything that can be represented counts as a person. And that's certainly Hobbes' view. Hobbes gives us an example of persons by fiction, states, but also strange examples, a hospital, a bridge. These are persons because they can be represented. Someone unauthorized could step forward and say, the hospital regrets the death of its patient. That's the person of the hospital speaking. Bufendorf thinks it's ridiculous to attribute personhood to things, because persons, he thinks, must have moral qualities as well as physical qualities. And obviously, the hospital is just bricks, doesn't have moral qualities. But for Bufendorf, the state does have moral qualities because it has a will. Of course, it has to be represented by somebody else, but the state has a will. And so for Bufendorf, the state is, of course, a persona, but it's a persona moralis. Very important distinction. It's a persona ficta, but it's a persona moralis, whereas the hospital is just a persona ficta. So, I mean, Bufendorf's view is that that's what Hobbes should have said, that the state is a persona moralis. And that idea comes back into Anglophone thought in the Enlightenment. The two great moments to mention, one is the translation of Bufendorf in 1717, but second, perhaps even more important, is another thoroughly Bufendorfian work, Emily Vattel's treatise on the law of nations, published in the English language as early as 1760. Vattel is, as you know, one of the great Enlightenment treatises on the European Union. And it begins by analysing how we should understand the state, because it's a theory about relations between states. I quote, this is the English translation. As a union of individuals, the state is the name of a distinct moral person, possessed of an understanding and will peculiar to itself. Separate states may in turn be regarded as moral persons living together in a natural society. Furthermore, Vattel goes on in purely Hobbesian vein, states are by intention immortal, for otherwise the relations between states cannot be regulated. And of course, what he centrally has in mind is treaties on international law. Who are the signatories of treaties? They must be the person of the state, the persona moralis of the state. Now, at this stage, what I'm calling this fictional theory, the view that the state is a persona moralis or persona ficta, catches the attention of English jurists, and it catches the attention of the greatest of all English jurists, William Blackstone, in his commentaries on the laws of England, 1765. This has a philosophical preliminary, as Blackstone himself calls it, and it's purely Hobbes. Or rather, it looks to me as if it's Hobbes filtered through the translation of Bufendorf. Anyway, this is really coming into the center of English jurisprudence. Blackstone beginning, the only true and natural foundation of society the wants and fears of individuals. There can be no natural union, but only a political union. And then he goes on, now quoting Leviathan, everyone must agree to submit their private wills to the will of one or assembly of men to whom supreme authority is entrusted, so that there is one uniform will, and the name of this will is the union of the state. For the state is a collective body, composed of a multitude united for their safety and acting together as if it is one person. The supreme power is the power of making laws, and that power is the power of the state. Well, that view that the state is a particular kind of its own victim, its own morality, is extraordinarily important in later Enlightenment thought, recurring, I suppose, most famously in the Contrat Social, where l'état is defined, as we call, as personne morale. L'état, c'est une personne morale. And subsequently, of course, taken up into Hegelian political philosophy, largely Hobbes, and central to public law, France and Germany, above all, throughout the 19th century. But I'm telling the Anglophone story, and at the end of the period of Enlightenment, an extraordinary thing happens to genealogy, which is that the Anglophone story skips off in a completely different direction. And I bring my genealogy to an end with that skipping off. This is initiated by Jeremy Bentham, the greatest of the reforming jurists of the late 18th century in England, whose first published work, which is called A Fragment of Government, was published in 1776 and takes the form, it takes no other form than an intense and vituperative critique of exactly the passages from Blackstone that I have just quoted. Launching his attack, Bentham announces, I quote, "The season of fictions is now over. The time has come to ground legal argument on observable facts about real individuals, and especially their capacity for experiencing in relation to political power the pain of restraint and the pleasure of liberty." So, Bentham's response after that tirade to Blackstone's description of the state of nature, the union of the multitude, the creation of the state, is, Bentham says, I quote, "I pronounce these remarks of Blackstone's completely meaningless." They're not false, they just have no meaning at all, because they're just fictions, and fictions is what the law must overcome. And that, of course, is the core of Benthamite jurisprudence. So, of course, that purported demystification leaves Bentham with nothing to say about the state, except that, as he says, if it has any meaning at all, the word, and here's the crucial moment, can only refer to those who are actually in charge of some identifiable apparatus of government. So you get this completely reductionist account. What is the state? It can't be a fictional person. You've got to get rid of that whole notion. It just means, it's just a way of working. And that runs all the way through classical utilitarianism. If you look at the classical utilitarians of the first generation, I mean, Paley or Godwin or Mill, they never talk about the state. Whereas, of course, it's central to discourse in France and in Germany. Why not? Because it's a fiction. And we don't do legal fictions. And the classic case of this is the most important work of strict jurisprudence of 19th century utilitarianism is John Austin's The Province of Jurisprudence Determined, 1832. I quote, "The term state can only denote the individual person or body of individual persons who in fact bear supreme power over an independent political society." So, you find no discourse of the state until there's some reaction against this sort of blip in my genealogy at the end of the 19th century, when something truly remarkable happens in English legal and political philosophy, which is a sudden reception, not just of Hegelian political philosophy, not just of Hegel, very important, but more interestingly perhaps, of German ideas about the real personality of corporations, especially as outlined by Otto von Dierker in his mighty, massive series of treatises on the personality, on the persona of corporations. Now, the Hegelian strand is taken up in a very crude but extraordinarily influential way at the end of the 19th century in England, above all by the figure of Bernard Bosanquet in his treatise of 1899 called The Metaphysical Theory of the State. And this is it's very crude. It's Hegel against Hobbes. So Bosanquet praises Hobbes for having recognized that the state is the name of a persona, but he criticizes him for not seeing what Hegel has seen, which is that this is not a fictional person, it's a real person. so Bosanquet's response to Hobbes, and I quote, this is Bosanquet, it is most Hegelian, is, the state is a person who possesses his own, notice it's masculine, his own real and substantial will, the contents of which are equivalent to what we would ourselves will if we were acting with rationality. So the real is irrational, and the state is our rationality. So it's a real person, it is our rational will. And so, in what came to seem a sinister moment, it's never rational to disobey the state, because that's disobeying our own rational will. But I find more interesting the extraordinary reception in Anglophone thought of the same period of Otto von Guericke's treatise on Genossenschaft. Especially because it captured the imagination of the greatest historian of legal and political theory of England, namely F.W. Maitland, in the closing years of the 19th century. Maitland, England's greatest historian, I think, Maitland translated Guericke, a huge task. He learned German in order to do it and wrote a fascinating introduction on the personality of corporations. And his final essays before his untimely death were on corporation theory. And the reason why he thinks we cannot do without the concept of the state as a purportedly immortal person separate from government and the government. And the reason that Maitland gives came from a particular crisis that was important in the very last years of the 19th century, which was the crisis of sovereign debt in South America, which is what he addresses himself to. And he asks, who is the debtor? Well, he says we can't answer that the debtor must be the governments involved, because the whole point is that they can't pay. They can't stand this debtor, because we have the same problem now. The level of public debt is such that no government can pay it. Maitland goes on, nor can the debtor be a succession of governments, because the debt will remain even if there is no government at all, which may yet happen to Greece. So Maitland proposes the only candidate, the only person who can be the debtor, must be a person sufficiently enduring to eventually to repay this debt, but it will be beyond the natural life of any government. And the only candidate is the person of the state. Okay, however, in Anglophone political philosophy, that was thought rather dangerously German. And what it produces is simply vociferous restatements of what I'm calling the reductionist view of the state, of which by far the most irascible was the reply by Hobhouse in his book called Metaphysical Theory of the State, sarcastic title of 1918. Confronted as he is by Bosanquet's claim that the state is the person who wills the will of the people, Hobhouse says, but what do we mean by the word state? By this word state, we mean the government, or more accurately, the organization that lies behind the law and government. The state is the name of governmental organization. It can mean nothing else. So that brings the genealogy down into the 20th century. And indeed, it brings me right back to the beginning of my lecture, which is now coming to a close, because that's the reductionist story that we have. I mean, that has been the Anglophone story throughout the rest of the 20th century. State and government, they're synonyms. They're just ways of talking about bureaucratic and legal and legislative power. Okay, well, I was asked to talk up to the hour, and I have 2 minutes left, and I promise you I will manage. But genealogy is always meant to be critique, and I'm going to use these closing moments, if I may, to try to take stock of my own genealogy. I asked at the beginning, and now I ask it again, do we think that anything of value has been lost in this extraordinary conceptual shift that I've traced, too, of course, but in the idea that the state is simply the name of government, as opposed to being the name of a distinct persona moralis? Is anything lost by having given up that whole way of thinking? Well, we've seen as we've gone along that its protagonists have thought that there are various things to be said in favour of it. and are true above all. First, there are reasons why it seems you can't do without the idea of a state as a locus of political power, capable of surviving the collapse of all government, so unequatable with government. But what are those reasons? Well, Vattel, of course, talks a great deal about one. When, as I said, he talks about the signatories of treaties. Signatories of treaties can't be governments. Treaties can't end when governments change. So who are the signatories? There's only one candidate, and that's the person of the state, somehow represented. Another example you've just seen, Mencken emphasizing, public debt, what is now called evasively sovereign debt, it should be called state debt. Who can be the debtor? The debtor can't be governments, it can't be us, it can't be any belonging to us. The only person who can reasonably be held to be the debtor must be a person, as Hobbes would say, purportedly immortal, that is, the person of the state. And interestingly, this has been, I think, brilliantly taken up by Janet McLean, legal philosopher, in her very recent book called Looking for the State, in which she says, and I quote, in the present state of contract law, there are many instances in which there's no way of making sense of legal obligations to governments other than that of invoking the idea of the state as a distinct moral person. But secondly, there's a more general reason, and here I really do close, for asking if we might think again about the fictional theory, which is that, as I've been saying all through, it's presented essentially as a way of distinguishing the legitimate parts of government. Governments can be tyrannical, but it's a way of saying what makes governments legitimate, namely their duty to procure the good of the state. But is that a possible way of thinking about political obligation? Well, that's the big question. And the response of current Anglophone liberal theory is it can't possibly be, because it invokes a substantial notion of the common good, whereas we have to grant political obligation on the rights of individuals. That is a requirement of justice. And that's the central claim of John Rawls's treatise on justice, and why it's not a treatise on the state. And I have to, of course, admit that in modern pluralist society is increasingly marked by rival incommensurable understandings of the good. It is very hard to think of the legitimacy of governments in terms of the capacity to pursue the good of the state, that's to say, the common good of its members. But as we've seen, a range of answers is given by proponents of this fictional theory. That the duty of the state is at least to procure the security of its people, and at least to make sure that they're saved from destitution and death, and at least to try to maintain an element of civil peace. Now, those are presented by writers in traditional fictional theory as obvious public goods. And they do sound like obvious public goods. You might think the onus is on those who want to say that those are not public goods to show why this is not a way of thinking about political obligation that should maybe be more of a challenge to prevailing liberalism than it currently is. Just one final thought and then I stop. The frequent objection, of course, to that is that this turns the state into a sinister entity, and that may be true if you think of the state as a real person. But if you think of it as a merely fictional person, then what we're saying is that the state is nothing other than us. We do not bring any new substances into the world by creating the state. We do not bring a real person into existence. We bring a moral person into existence. But that moral person is us. So that to speak of the duty of the state, the duty of government to procure the good of the state, is simply a façon de parler. It is to talk about how to procure the common good. The question at the end then, and this is the end, is, but are those sufficiently good reasons for thinking in these terms? Well, as you see, I hardly need to emphasize it, but I presented myself to you this evening as an historian. All I've tried to do do is to excavate, to bring back to the surface, a tradition of thinking about the state that has been largely lost to sight, and to ask whether you think it might be worth renewing some interest in it. But as to whether you find any interest in it, that is not for me to say, that is for you to say, and thank you for your patience in hearing it. Thank you very much.